And welcome to Ireland and to County Kildare, to Kill, the home of the Dunne family.
Now how about this, folks? This is a palace. There's Thomas there doing his bit. This is a palace. It is the Dunne's Palace here in County Kildare. And this fella is a real star. This is Porterstown Chris. Now then, Geoff, pride and joy here, Porterstown Chris.
Yeah, he's a member of the family now, isn't he? Eight year old this year. He's named after my late brother Chris. And it's pride of place here. He has been for the last number of years, and it took me a long time to name a horse after Christopher, but I think in naming him, I think I named a good horse, and it took time, but he's proved to be a good horse. Maybe not a top three for Otter, but you know, he's been beaten in 55 by a short head, is a record of 56. So, you know, he's up there with him. And family bred, home bred, by Doonbeg, by our own horse, out of our own mare that we've had for 20 years. So, you know,
he's a pet.
It's worked out well.
Yeah, he's a pet.
You can see him here, he's a family pet. Like he's.
He looks so well in his coat. Now, so he's a horse who goes well fresh.
Yeah, we always find he goes real well fresh. A couple of times he's went to Tear Prince. He's gone good early on in the year. He's won a crop of gold here twice early. And today's Wednesday, 4th of May. We're going Saturday night for the Anto Russell Memorial night. So fingers crossed he goes good. I know he will go good. He doesn't need racing luck and, you know, decent draw. There's only seven in it. So like, he gets a nice draw and things go right. I'm not bringing him for nothing. Like he has a chance, like, you know.
But he's dined at the top table. He's run against the top draw free for allers. He's a top draw free for aller himself. And you know, time wise, tell us about some of the times he's clocked.
Well, on the VDM day 2 years ago, Tetrick bet him on the line. If you remember, 55-1. Chris cut the whole mile. Tetrick just got him on the line. He's gone 57 numerous times in Tear Prince. 56-4 is his official winning record in Portmarnock. He didn't have a great year last year for some reason. I don't know whether he was overtrained or we undertrained him or he was a bit heavy. He's still a bit heavy there now even today, but he's a bit lighter than he was now, mind you. But he walked here a couple of weeks ago in a nice time. And we just, myself, me dad and Jonathan, just think it's one last crack this year with him, and you know, we're thinking about selling him, thinking about retiring him. I think I'll probably end up just retiring him.
You can't sell him, he's a pet.
No, I'll end up just...
be like selling your missus.
I'll sell him, probably a bit quicker. I'll retire him. Hopefully I'm here and I'm looking at him and he's 30 years of age. Do you know what I mean?
Yes, So what are you thinking about? Well, here we are now in May. We're thinking about, you know, Crock of Gold and the like.
Crock of Gold. I tell you what, we're very looking forward to Tregaron being on early, because Tregaron has been a bit unlucky with the weather, but the weekend that's on now, it's just prime, isn't it? And people that run Tregaron are very good to us, and I just think there's a free-for-all on the grass. I just think he will absolutely love it.
And tell us,
it's early in the
year. It's early, so that will help, so hopefully dry conditions.
Yeah. And even a bit of give, but the whole thing for us is early, you know, it's very early July, you know, watch it now. 8 weeks away, you know.
Yeah.
So.
And at 8 years old, I mean, in terms of form, where he is now, do they really improve from eight, or would you think he's plateaued?
I think he's plateaued. Saturday night is going to be a big judge.
Yeah.
You know, if he doesn't go real good Saturday night, I'll retire him Saturday night.
Right.
You know, because I'm not going to be dogging him around or doing that. He didn't have a good season last year. I have a sneaky feeling myself, bottom weight went on. I don't know, but if he doesn't, like, he's going real well here. That doesn't mean sometimes they go racing, they don't go as good either, but if he doesn't go a real good Saturday night, now we'll probably retire him.
Okay, he's training well and he looks perfect. Magnificent.
I think there's a big race on Saturday night.
Yeah, so this is Porterstown Chris. He won't be sold, but the missus is going. Now here, Geoff, we've got Tara with CJ, and I've got to say, you know, we see horses well turned out time and time again, but this fella looks an absolute picture, real. You've got to be really proud of the way he's actually looking, and ability-wise, you know, he can do it. We know he can do it.
Yeah, and he likes tear prints. You know, he won a Port Marnock on Sunday in 2 minutes in a stroll. Bernard actually drove him himself. Bernard Brendan trains him now himself. He bought him off Paul Bennett last year. And himself and Thomas have just got really stuck into him and just treating him like a pet and just minding him and it's paying off at him, like, the 2 minutes in a jog on Sunday. And as you can see, you can look at him, like, he's as good a horse as you see anywhere, isn't he? The looks.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
You know, he's a good horse. I think he's unbeaten probably maybe in Tear Prince. I think he's been maybe three times, he's won the three times. He's gone Saturday night. He's in a junior free for all. It is a big step up for him. But you know, if he puts his mind to it, there's a couple of real good horses in the race, Porterstown Courage and whatnot, but you know, I think he's not going out for nothing, is he, you know?
No. Tell us about his race record thus far.
Well, he won the three-year-old. He was a bit sketchy at the start. But, like, in his three-year-old, we didn't race him at two. His three-year-old season, he won 5 out of 7 starts. He's only beaten twice. He won the VDM three-year-old derby final in 1:57 as a three-year-old. He went to Tregaron after that. He won the Heat. A bit unlucky in the final. I think he turned off in the final. You know, Jonathan wasn't able to go because his partner was having the baby. So we had Grant Cullen on, and Grant drove him perfect, but just maybe not being used to him. And I think maybe CJ might have played it. You know, he just didn't keep up for him, you know, in the final. And that was really that. And then later on that year, then Crockett Golan, like, he went to Tear Prince and he won again. So yeah, I think he's five wins a three-year-old, and then last year he had a couple of good wins as well. He won in Tear Prince as well the last day of the season. Jonathan drove him. So, like, he's not a horse that, you know, when he's been away, he's not been out. He's never finished down the field, right? Like, he's been up there. He's been up there with him, and see Saturday night being much different.
So what are the aspirations for 2019 with this fella?
Well, Bernard only took out his licence, and he's kind of doing them himself, and he's in it for the sport more than, you know, he's not going for any big races. It's just for him to get his confidence with him. He drove him on Sunday himself. He won with him in 2 minutes in the canter. So it's more just for him to, you know, get going and get a bit of confidence with him, and it's doing the trick for him. Like in some ways, like, Paul Bennett named him after his son as well, like Tarwood CJ, Charlie Jr. He's family bred, home bred, Pa bred him, you know, not a big man, expensive purchase, and it's working out well, you know.
Well, I'll tell you what, you won't see a grander looking horse.
No, he's a nice horse, and he's coming of age, like, only 5-year-old there now, you know, so, you know, he's a nice pony.
So that's Tara Wood CJ. Okay, Geoff, let's introduce Patsy Camden.
Yeah, she's a 3-year-old Western Ideal filly that, Buddy and Paul bought over in off McWelling, and maybe a month or two later on, after that, I bought a share. So we're a three-way split now. She's going Tear Prince Saturday night with the maid. She can go farm. She was in Port Marnock basically this morning, had her last little walk out. Alan Richardson was walking her out. Alan's going to drive her on Saturday night. Jonathan didn't originally know he was going, so we just had to have a driver in place. But she's going. Our 2-year-old career wasn't that good. We only raced her twice or three times. The day of the VDM, she stopped, she tied up, and that's all down to me. I made a boo-boo that morning. I left her out. I went down to see somebody, and I left her out too long. So I take that all on my back. I'm just putting her away then. But she's working out nicely now. She's going for a maiden. The maiden Tear Prince on Saturday night, looking at the card, it looked fairly hot. So if she's placed in the first three, like, we'll be over the
moon. Aren't they? Generally, maidens certainly in the first place, half of the season, yeah, Tear Prince are very strong.
Well, you know, you have horses out there that can go up to be anything. It's the start of the year. Yeah. Every horse is starting out. So, you know, don't forget, like, Miraculous, Meticulous, they all have to start off as a maiden somewhere. So, obviously, they were stakes horses, but, like, plenty of good horses start off in the maidens. And yeah, win, lose, or draw, once she goes scored and we get a bit of luck and she gets around, that's all we want.
Really, and has she grown much during the winter?
Not so much in height, maybe more filled out, you know. She's not an over big filly, but I don't really like our horses over big anyway, just a nice size, and she's great temperament, you know, she's doing everything right, doesn't wear any boots, nothing, you know, wears a closed eye bridle, a playing pole, that's it. No other harness, no quirks with her, nothing, just.
So how important was it to take her to a track today for a workout, pre-season workout?
Well, she's as green as grass, I think, as well, you know, so where the lads bringing her out there this morning, she's seen a lot more stuff around her for Saturday night. It's, you know, Alan Richardson met the lads out there, he walked her out there. It's just that it's more to show her the track, so Saturday night is not as big a shock to her as it could be, let's say, probably.
And then going forward, obviously, get that first win under the belts, and then
it'd be nice now if it's Saturday night. If it's not, could be in Portman the following week, or it could be, you know. Well, she's entered for everything. She's entered for the BDM 3-year-old fillies. She's well staked up in the Breeders' Crown. Pretty sound filly. She pulled one of her front shoes off in the grass maybe 3 weeks ago, kind of gave her a slight wrench, but she's come over that. The blacksmith, I think, left the shoe maybe a bit long.
That's a question I've asked a few trainers. Would you work your horses out on grass at all?
Yeah, we have walked some out. We got our new paddocks fitted, so the track that we were going to use has a bit of a grass, which I'll show you later on. That's gone now, for once. But I generally feel once they get around a good track, they'll get, like, grass tracks are not like they were before. Like Aberystwyth, Tregaron, and all the tracks are perfect now, aren't they? They're as good as tracks. Go to the track, pull a hole, that's it. Pull one hole, the hole will be easy. That's, you know, obviously some horses like it better, a bit of give.
Yeah.
But, years ago, maybe getting horses ready for Musselburgh, we used to go up to Nate's race car, so we even went to the quarter once or twice. But I think it jades the horse too much, whereas now we just try and keep them fresh. And sometimes you can do too much before you go.
Yes.
That's the big thing.
So this is Patsy Camden, well staked up.
Yeah.
Now then, Benny Grendon's here. Now, Benny, just introduce. Wow. Yeah, you're all in shock now.
Yeah. Right,
Benny, introduce this star in the making.
This is Rainbow Rider, both Sports Rider and Hepburn Blue Chip.
That's some breeding.
Yeah, it's great breeding. Yeah, I always wanted a Sports Rider, you know.
Yeah.
Christy helped me with that down the line, so.
Right, and just tell us a little bit about this horse.
Yeah, she's just going off easy now. We're just taking her down easy, you know. Just taking her time, now ready for the VDM.
Right.
We'll see whatever else. Probably the Breeders' Crown probably come along. And
so, when she'd have been training from what, January?
Yeah, January.
Yeah. And the sort of feel that she's giving in.
Great feel.
Yeah.
Yeah, very, very happy with her. Starting about her, you know. Do everything nice and neat.
And in terms of where will she race over the coming weeks, what's the plan? I know the BDM is the ultimate plan.
Yeah, and probably at the Tear Prince probably as well, you know.
Yeah.
She'll probably go on a couple of qualifiers, will she? Yeah. And then she'll obviously go for the BDM prep races. Don't normally race them as much. I think with this video we're going to try and race them. We're going to race her a bit more for the BDM. Mm. So, like, you've a couple of prep races, and then going to try and race her in a few maidens. Like, she's well advanced. She was in Port Marnock race with this morning for experience, and she's probably as advanced a filly that's ever been here time wise at this part. Like, it's only today's the 1st of May.
Yeah.
And she's already down, going a good clock. So, but she's unreal bred. Like, always sports right around with. The better's the nightmare. Benny always wanted a sports right, yeah. So
you paid peanuts for her then?
Sorry?
You paid peanuts?
I wouldn't call you peanuts then.
Let's just say, I think she was very good value. It's probably the way I'd describe her. But she's a pet. Everything about her. Just...
So has she been very professional in terms of...
From day one.
In terms of greenness, I mean, how green has she been? Or has the penny dropped quickly?
So it's coming to that there now, I'd say, you know. It's just, she's doing everything so natural, you know. Everything's so natural to her. She's a pleasure to deal with.
I think they're well handled, them Yankee horses, before they come over too. Yeah. It makes a big difference to see them. And they're always foal. Like, I think she's probably a February foal. So look, she's a bit early. But even looking ahead now, like, she's advanced the legs. She's just a nice finish. But here, that means nothing either. You know, like I said, we come to the end of the summer and you don't know. But like at the minute, like it's still very early days. What, the VDL is probably 12, 13 weeks away. You know.
Because she's a fair way forward at this stage.
Yeah, and at the same time, we don't want to peak in too quick either. No. And then, you know, we're a bit over the top. But, and even you can see, like, the Phillies division has been a strong division for a few years in the VDM.
Yes.
But there's more races than the VDM too. Like, she's Sawyer State, or she's State, not Sawyer, she's obviously not Sawyer State because she's Yankee, but she's in the Breeders' Crown. The Breeders' Crown's going to be a big part. Obviously, the VDM and a couple of other nice races as well. Do you know, but couldn't get her there, get her there in one shape.
So who's going to be sitting in the sulky, Benny?
I don't know. I don't know if Benny's going to pull Benny, but I'll be hoping Jonathan or Benny's view starts
on there. If I lose about 6 stone, I should be out.
Well, I can tell you're really excited and she's a pride and joy.
She really is, yeah. She really, really is.
So here we are, 1st of May. We're talking about the VDM, Rainbow Writer.
Rainbow Writer.
By Sports Writer.
She even has the head cut on.
Yeah. Right, let's hope, mid-August, I'm talking to you on that Sunday afternoon.
Yeah.
Yeah. Benny, good luck.
Thank you very much.
Now, Geoff, we're on your track here.
This is the back stretch here we're on now.
Which actually goes around the houses.
Goes around the houses, yeah. If you look at this pole here, that's the three-quarter pole.
Right.
That's actually the quarter pole down there.
Right. How many horses could you get across the track here?
I think three in jog carts comfortably, you know, for when you get to the bend. It's 100 yards short of a half mile, so you've two laps and 100 yards. Doonbeg track record holder. He's gone around at 57.
Yeah.
Porterstown Chris gone around at 2 minutes. He's for real about 59 around it. There's been some good horses, have raced it. A big part of the thing is you see paddocks, letting horses out in paddocks and getting a bite of grass.
Yes, yes. It's been a wonderful setup here, Geoff.
That's a big part. You see grass and paddocks, and if you look at that grass, good old grass. The paddocks are not overused. There's 6 paddocks, so you can see this. Maybe Dad is there now. There's a wee pole there. That's where he is there now, is the start.
Yeah.
And I've said it's 100 yards to finish here, but he comes down here now. I'll tell you. If you look under the near where he is and see the red pole again, kind of on the ground.
Yes.
See where his front wheel of his tractor is.
Yeah, got him now.
Now, that's the half.
Right.
And obviously, it's, you know, 45 or 50 yards. It's probably maybe 95 yards.
Now just tell us a little.
To finish this, so 2 laps.
Yeah.
And that finishes it.
Now tell us a little bit about, obviously, we know how successful you've been with the training of horses, but also breeding has been a very important part of your harness racing interest and association. And Doonbeg, I mean, just turn the clock back with Doonbeg. I mean, racing days, he's a horse who needs no introduction to the British and Irish fans. I mean, Christ, before that, in the United States, he's a horse who qualified for the little brown jug.
Yeah, he skipped in the heat. He still went 50 in his heat, but he always had respiratory problems, bad respiratory problems, and we knew the owners well, and they just want him to go to a good home, and that's how we got him. We got him home. We got one little operation done on him. Vet Pat McGrath put him on some tablets and stuff, and we brought him around, and we've never had. They told me originally he was allergic to grass. Look, I've never heard of that before. But we just put him on grass straight away. Yeah, vet said won't be any problem, and the rest is history, isn't it? With him, you know what I mean.
How many seasons did he race for you?
It was 4 seasons with him. We raced in 09. I drove him myself to 4 start in Amman Valley. He won that. So he raced in 09. He raced in 10, raced 2012. He was off for 2013. He had an injury. He came back in 2014 and he won all around him, and we retired him in Tregaron in 2014. So, you know, 5 or 6 years, and it's 4 or 5 years. But
I wasn't at Amman Valley, but I do remember the
occasion. Yeah, it was a real muddy day. Yeah, and he broke the world record in Amman Valley as well then. He was a lucky horse there, he'd been a few times. But the people in Amman Valley are such good people too. They make you so welcome. That's a big thing too.
Yes.
And it's a track for Doombeg, isn't it? Small, get around the bends, gets around no bother.
And he really, you know, he really hits Christie again. He's just showing off now. Yeah. He was the pocket rocket.
He was.
But the interesting thing about Doombeg, he had bags and bags of speed, but he could also stay trips as well. And if you look at the horses he's actually throwing now as a stallion, they're actually, you know, horses that can stay trips.
Yeah, even you look at John Barley going to Musselburgh, no problem, Triplicate was only a 4-year-old filly when we raced her in Musselburgh, and won her heat, and she was toured to Son of a Gun and Mikey Camden. Like, for a 4-year-old filly, it's not me and feet, you know what I mean? But same boy Doombeg, but like, I think Doombeg is, at one stage, he held 7 records. He held Corby Wood, he held Musselburgh, Torella, Cork, he even held Portmarnock for a while, Amman Valley, the world record then. Like, he's just been something a bit special that not everybody gets, you know.
How many mares would benefit from the Doombeg service in a year?
Gwennon said to me last year, see, Gwennon looks after him in Wales for me, so he goes over there, so he goes from home to home, and he's minded like a baby. And like last year he had 65 plus mares. He's been the most used stallion in the UK in the last 2 years. And here, there's horses out there, some certain prices. He's 500 quid. He's there for the working man. He's there for everyone. He's in Wales. Like, you know, he's turned some ordinary mares, you know, and made race horses out of them. And that's no disrespect to anyone. Me and Gwennon decided we're not changing prices. Just leave the price as it is. He's value for people. People that were loyal to him keep going back to him. And, you know, he's probably could be worth any price, but like he's there. He's priced for. He's priced for everybody, I think, you know. And the results are there. Like,
didn't Jody Jameson drive him?
Jody drove him to Crockett Gold. Jonathan fell in Tregaron in 2010 and broke his shoulder. And Jody came over, and Jody flew all the way over to drive him. Yeah. But it was a horrible night in Tear Prince, if you remember. Yes. The downpours. And Jody got away last. Dollar won it. Dollar went super. But Jody just set in last, and the race was over. The race was over before it began then, you know. So, he's never really a real lucky horse in Tear Prince. It's because I think a lot of Tear Prince depends about getting out the gate and stuff. And one thing Doombeg didn't have, he didn't have gate speed. Everything else, like distance, like 1.5 record in Cork, Musselburgh record he held, but just could not get out the gate.
Yes.
But once you got away and got a position, he'd always come home for you, you know.
So his name is still in lights.
Yeah, he's one of the pets too.
Now, over the last 12 months or so, we enjoyed some really good races between the likes of Robin Camden and Reclamation. I think Robin Camden beat Reclamation 5 or 6 times over here in this part of the world. Both horses have now ended up in North America, and they're both performing really well.
They're both performing brilliant, yeah. The mares now, the 4-year-old, but two real nice mares. They've went over, you know, they've done super well, and you know, for the connections, and here good, great connections on both horses, like the Morphys and Phil Donovan that own Reclamation. Like, you won't get nicer people. Clive and Jason that own Robin, top of the range, you won't get nicer people. So, you know, it's good people have them, and it's great when they go over there. Like, it's, you know, it's shining a light on racing in Ireland and England that, like, these horses can, you know. Obviously, Reclamation was bred in the States, but like Mickey Welland bred Robin, and you know, I know she's like, obviously she's American bred, but like she was bred in the UK, and she's.
So who actually owns Robin Camden then? Because Clive Kavanagh.
It's called All Out Syndicate. So there's Clive, Jason, another Jason, and there's one other lad. I don't really know his name. Yeah. There's 4 lads in total on them, and but Clive treated her like a baby. Clive, even though she was here and that, and. Like, Clive was Clive was the trainer, was heavily involved. Like, we were all heavily involved. Like, it's very hard to get a filly, 2-year-old, 3-year-old, raced everywhere and keep her unbeaten. And she went away unbeaten, 14 out of 14. But she was once, like, you talk about Doombeg and having Chris as good horses, like, but like, she is definitely a once in a lifetime filly. Like, I can't see us ever having another.
So the plan, obviously, long-term plan is to turn her into a brood mare, but you wanted to get her name out there on the big stage in the US first.
Yeah, and she's racing in Yonkers this Friday night, but she's been very unlucky with draws. Like, she drew 7 last week, she's drawn 6 this week. You know, she's been unlucky with draws, but at the same time, she hasn't let herself down. She's been going fabulous, racing great on the half-mile track. And the main plan is then just Clive's going to put her in foal for a real good stallion. And I don't know if he's going to bring her straight home or have a foal and then bring another foal home in the belly. I don't know.
So would this be her last year or only year?
I don't know that for definite. No. I'd say she might race a 5-year-old because she's unlikely to race. She only raced 14 times for 2 and 3-year-old. You know, so I think she's probably raced that since she went away. You know, so.
But you guys can take real pride in watching the likes of Robin Camden and for the Murphy's reclamation and what they're doing over there.
It's brilliant, like, you know. Yeah. Like, they haven't just went over and raced, they went over and they've dominated and won, like, you know, so.
Yeah.
Even, reclamation is, she's a filly of a lifetime too, isn't she? Like, you just see what she does, she comes out and she doesn't know when she's bit. I think the tracks over there are maybe suiting her better than they did here. She's such a big, rangy mare. And Murphy's done super, where even, like, get her around Tregaron and the Dragoness, you know, or the Little Wells Dragoness. For such a big filly, that's a feat in its own.
Yeah.
But I kind of always had a sneaky feeling myself when she got away and she got onto a big track, she would even be streets better again, you know.
You mentioned the Dragoness there, and you know, stakes racing is something that's close to your heart. It must be quite frustrating as well over here certainly in the UK anyway, looking at the programme of races, that most of the stakes races for 2 and 3-year-olds seem to be in the first half of the season.
Yeah, it's a terrible pity, like, that, you know, a lot of some of us not kept till after, let's say. I think what's had to happen in the last 5 years, because it's such a phenomenal race meeting, is the VDM. People are trying to, a lot of races are kind of walked around the VDM or around that weekend, which is a bit of a pity, because a lot of the big races in America or Canada are all after August. Like, I don't see why some of the big races in the UK couldn't be held, you know, late August. Obviously, with Tregaron being moved forward, there's a big gap there, like, from, you know, the 15th of August until the 15th of September. Like, there's a full month, you know, have a couple of good races, good stake, good pots. I don't see why, you know, you couldn't have some real good racing. With the way it's going at the minute, should the season's over after the VDM.
Yeah.
You know, and that's, and it's very hard.
You made a point to me that some horses have actually only just turned 2 when they're running in these big races in June, July.
You can have, like, even races there in York or in Tier Prince, let's say, hypothetically, in June, the end of June. So, like, a lot of them foals could have been in on your barn in June.
Yeah.
It's a big ask, like, but I don't know. It's very hard. Whatever it has been hard for the likes of Rocker or Mick Lord, whatever, based in England, they can just jump in the truck and go. We have to jump on a ferry. And like, you can't bring 2-year-olds on a ferry, you know, every week.
Yeah.
That's just not going to happen. Like, you nearly, like, for us, you nearly want them a month apart.
Yeah.
Which is not going to happen. But having races week after week, it's just very hard. I think it's sad for racing, because you're not going to get the full benefit of all the good horses racing.
There needs to be a lot more structure, and there needs to be communication between Britain and Ireland, surely, on planning the big race dates.
Yeah, you know, stretch the stakes races out a bit more. Like, they don't need to be all in a cluster, because even you have your big, well, obviously Aberystwyth's gone now, but you have all your big race meetings too, kind of close together, and. Like, it could be a much of a rubber week, and then the next week in York there could be, like, you know, Sire Stakes or whatever. Like, I know you need racing every week too, but like, we only have a pool of so many horses. It's hard for them to race every week, you know. Yeah. And that's just the way I feel. I think the younger races, they're a bit all on top of each other. That's just, I don't see why there couldn't be a couple of real good races in September, and it would keep the likes of Tier Prince open, because, you know, if you're going for, like, a race and there's big money for it, you're going to keep the horse in training, aren't you?
And it's funny, it's serious, but you're all singing from the same hymn sheet. All you trainers, all you owners are saying the same thing.
Yeah. I don't know. It might change, you know.
It might change, yeah. But listen, I really do appreciate everything you've done for me today. I've really enjoyed my visit.
It's great to see you.
Yeah, to seeing you guys operating here in County Kildare. You've got a lovely setup. And may I wish you all the very best for 2019.
Thanks a million, Darren Lee.
Well, I'm signing off here in County Kildare. Guys, thank you very much for your time today.
More than welcome, Darren. You're welcome anytime.
We're looking forward to 2019. Here's the real worker, it's Thomas here.
He's shy.
So,
lads, go ahead there, Rebecca.
The season's already, we've already started the season at Portmarnock. Yeah. I believe it's already working out well for you.
It is indeed, yeah. He's giving me a bit of a run there on Sunday. Tara with CJ there, and absolutely ecstatic the way he ran. Lovely run out, nice wind, first wind, you know.
That's brilliant.
Absolutely.
First class, I'm delighted for him.
Yeah, that's brilliant. So, going back to this Rainbow Rider, you got Rainbow Rider for peanuts, I believe, Christy.
Peanuts? Yeah. Nuts.
Nuts.
Shells out.
Shells. Because he's a good lad. He likes the job that he's doing, and he's worth to give it to him, because he'll keep him.
I can see he's passionate.
Yeah, he's passionate. He loves the job.
Yeah.
And it's cost him a lot of money to get where he wants to here.
Yeah.
And now his fruit is going to pay off, because he's two lovely three-year-olds, a two-year-old, and CJ's going to have a bit of fun with.
We need more people like him.
Without a doubt, Darren.
Yeah.
If more people like him, the job would be flying.
Yeah. Lads, I wish you all the very best.
Thanks very much, Darren.
Much indeed, Darren.